They have all of the kids wearing masks and they have them keeping their head down. They're telling them to hide their face. Many of these kids go missing.
I've even had a little friend. I can't remember her name, but she said she didn't know where she would go.
And MVM is an organization that has moved out.
I don't work for you.
You do not work for MVM?
I'm on vacation.
You said that you were on vacation, and now you're moving this small child to the airport. I thought you were on vacation. Do you have any comment about the children that have gone missing, that you've helped to escort across the country?
Two children were delivered to a sponsor that lives at this address. But as you can see, nobody lives here, and honestly, it doesn't look like anybody's lived here in quite a long time.
There's kids in the car here. They're moving these kids. They just turned the lights off.
We owe a debt of $10,000 for me. And another $10,000 for my brother.
That van that we just confronted, they are now taking off. We are following them. This van is now trying to lose us. They're driving through this neighborhood that's headed absolutely nowhere.
Are a lot of the kids coming over here, are they trafficked, or like, what's the...
Some are. I'm not gonna lie. Some are.
She cried because she didn't know what they would do with her. We went to sleep, and in the morning, when I got up, she was gone.
Good morning, Owasso. That is some scary stuff there. Our government is facilitating and working with human traffickers. In fact, we have another video that I'm going to pull up here. Hey, Chad, go ahead and pull up that Senator Hawley video, because this is exactly what he's talking about. This guy did the following and around, but like I said, Senator Hawley did the... he was grilling this chick who's in charge of this department.
Right.
And she has no answers.
Yeah. Give me 1 second. Let me pull that up. Yikes.
You bet.
Hang on.
But yeah, this is a sad state of affairs, folks. Like, if you are voting Democrat and you are voting for open borders policies, you are openly voting for the exploitation of children. I mean, this is insane. Like, that video is insane. Like, those paddle vans, I mean, those are government paddle vans. You know, like, that's the type of stuff that they shuttle us military folks around in whenever the group is small enough.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what are they doing with these kids? I mean, I get children have the right to privacy, but, I mean, if our tax dollars are sending these kids places, we ought to know where they're going. Shoot, the kids ought to know where they're going. And you have all these secret, super shady adults running around with them being, like, holding their hands, not saying anything, and running through. Like, at least the other immigrants that they interview, the ones that don't have kids, are like, oh, yeah, I'm going to California. I'm going to Chicago. I'm going to... New York. I'm going to Utah. It's like, at least they're excited to tell people where they're going, because they're just idiots, you know? But these people, something nefarious is going on, because they're dragging these kids, not saying a word, and nobody seems to have a problem with it, except for people on the right who are wanting to just halt immigration altogether. I mean, we don't want our country or our government involved in human trafficking. But again, I mean, with this whole Diddy stuff as well, it's like, I think the government works with these traffickers and works with people like Jeffrey Epstein and works with people like Diddy so they can get... I think they allow this kind of stuff to happen so they can have dirt on these people to get them to have leverage on them to get them to do what they want.
Mm-hmm.
And they give them basically prosecution immunity because they're affiliated or they are, you know, informants for the whatever three-letter agency you want to talk about, and then they just go, well, guess what? You've outlived your usefulness, like Tom Cruise and, you know, American Made. You've outlived your usefulness. We don't need you anymore.
Yep.
Bye.
I've got the video pulled up,
yeah,
if you're ready.
Go ahead. And so watch Tim Hawley grill this chick, or Senator Hawley grill this chick.
All right. I'm going to refresh it just to make sure.
Make sure you hit that sound.
Wait. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Marcos, can I just start with you? You testified a moment ago to Senator Butler that every child gets a Know Your Rights presentation. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Is that before or after you release them to labor traffickers?
Senator, every child that comes into our care gets a Know Your Rights presentation as well as...
Have you read these New York Times reports, these stories, the series of stories the New York Times has done on... the children who are in your care, have you read them?
Yes, I have.
Have you read that children are scrubbing dishes They are operating heavy machinery. They are delivering meals. They are harvesting coffee. They are working construction. They are working as housekeepers. They are working overnight shifts at plants where they are not paid. They are not going to school. They are not cared for. They are not giving meals. Almost all of it illegally. Are you aware of that? That's a yes or no?
Yes.
Do the Know Your Rights presentation help them in those situations?
Mm-hmm.
Senator ORR.
That's a yes or no, I think. Do you really think that you're helping these children by releasing them to labor traffickers and, yes, sex traffickers? 85,000 children whom you have no contact with, and your answer is we gave them a presentation before we turned them over to these people who are exploiting them on a scale not seen in this country for 100 years, a century. A century. It's a disgrace in the United States of America. Let me ask you this. Good. You did an audit, I noticed, right, where you gave yourself a clean bill.
Just tip my hat to Senator Hawley there. I mean, yeah, we haven't seen children exploited like this since the Rockefeller Foundation. They were like, get these kids in the get them in the shops, make them work, get them in the factories. We can use it's the anybody ever see Schindler's List?
Yeah.
It's the justification for him saving the... granted, he had noble causes for justifying saving those kids. These people don't. Like, he's like... he saved those little Jewish kids from the camp. It's like, I need the little fingers to clean the dirt out of the small bullet holes and stuff. Mm-hmm. It's like, I need them. It's like that, but they're like, no, we just want slave labor. We want child slaves and slave labor.
Yeah. And...
The African American community, if they're really upset about slavery and reparations and things like that, they should be outraged by this. But they don't care because they're only out for themselves.
And as we saw in the video that started off our show, each one of those children have accrued a $10,000 debt to whoever their labor sponsor is, and they have to pay it back.
And here's the other thing too: what's terrifying is, we've already seen that in Chicago, like the kids that come to Chicago that are in the school systems, the schools don't have the will or the funds. Like, and again, this is not a funding problem, but like I said, the kids who go there, they don't even speak the language. So there's no point in them being in class. They just go, sit in the corner and play on your phone while the rest of the kids actually attempt to learn, which distracts all the other kids in the environment because they could be over there playing Angry Birds. I mean, I don't know what the games, but you can play straight video games on your phone now. So Angry Birds, it's not like back in
your phone. You can play anything on your phone now.
People were playing, Angry Birds in the back of the class. That's about it. But that's the thing. It's a distracting environment now. So not only is Chicago a terrible school system, now you have a distraction with the fact that teachers don't have the will to teach all these kids that are coming from everywhere. It's not just Mexico. It's not just South America. Kids from all over the world are coming now, and they don't have the will to teach these kids how to speak English. They don't have the numbers. They don't have the resources. And like I said, again, I wouldn't even say it's a government resources problem. It's just the fact that they just don't have the will to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So what's going to happen? These kids are going to be useless members in this society because they can't speak the language. So they're just going to go, okay, go into the drug trade, go join a gang, or your slave labor, or join them, or become prostitutes. We're setting these people up for failure. Our immigration policy is setting these people up for failure. And it's setting up Chicago for the largest gang war that's ever going to happen. I mean, they're already saying, I've seen multiple videos of how black gangs are getting ready to start fighting
the Venezuelan gangs.
They're going to be like, we ain't tolerating this. Because like I said, they have their territories and maps on the maps charted out. And the Venezuelans don't have any territory. So they go, it's going to be like Tony Montana and Scarface. It's like, I want the world. And everything in it, and like that's what these Venezuelans are going to do. And again, the level of violence, we have not, like, I mean, look, Chicago's a violent city. More people die in Chirac than they did in Afghanistan in a year. So we just don't have the will to, they're going to be so violent. It's going to be so crazy. It's going to be stuff we haven't seen that I don't know if the gangs are actually going to have the will to fight it. Like, there was a biker gang war between a white biker gang and a cartel gang in California. The white biker gang lost immediately because they were not prepared for the level of violence that they were going to be facing. They were not prepared. Like I said, this is what's coming here. Again, Trump was right when they said they're not sending our best. They're sending the They're sending their violent gang members. They're entering their prisons. That's what they're doing. It'll be the level of violence that you will see in this country will be unprecedented. And again, if Trump wins, Democrats are literally just crapping on the table and leaving Trump a poop mess to clean up. Like, that's what this is. So, I mean, we gotta, I gotta stop rambling because we've got a ton of videos to go through today, Chad. If you just want to start showing stuff, pull up some of the other videos.
We've got so many, it's ridiculous just to show evidence that all these things that are being brought up about the migrant problems, about the immigration problems that aren't true, that Democrats are straight up saying that aren't true, are 100% true. And they're being willfully ignored by the Democratic Party and Kamala Harris administration and the Biden administration.
Yes, when charity, when your empathy actually hurts more people than it saves. Like I said, again, they're weaponizing empathy. Like, Democrats are weaponizing empathy from, like, oh, these people just want jobs. They just want this. They just want that. It's like, it doesn't matter what they want. What do they need? They need to stay in their own countries. They need to fix the problems that are in their countries, but they don't care. They want the benefits. They want the, like the Haitians in Ohio, they want the magic money cards that never run out of money. Again, you can pull up that video of that storage clerk chick who was like, hey, like, I mean, they have like $30,000 on these cards. Like, I'm struggling to pay the bills working two jobs, and these Haitians have $30,000 on these cards that they're given.
Here she is right here. I'll pull up the video in just a second. Let me get back to this screen. Make sure I've got sound on here. I do.
Watch this video. This is amazing. This is profound.
I can tell you personally that when I worked at the grocery store and I cashed them out, the receipts were alarming. $13,000 on EBT food, not including the $29,000 that was on EBT cash.
They had $30,000 on their EBT cash balance left.
Yes.
And as a cashier, you can see that.
Yes.
And you're like, holy shit, why do you have $30,000 on?
It's infuriating.
On one person's card.
It's infuriating. Yes, sir.
So they're not getting $600.
And while they're dressed very well. Very well. How are you able to dress like that? Coming over here as running for help that we're supposedly helping them? How are you dressed like that when we, the American people, are scrapping for the next set of work boots?
They can afford nice
clothes. That's a problem. That's a serious problem. But I can tell you personally that when I worked at the grocery store.
But, I mean, again, that is a blue-collar American lady there, working at a grocery store, working every day to pay her bills, feed her kids, and you have these people come in. Now they're dressed up super nice. They're dressed up fresh and fly. They're wrecking cars. They got the magic money cards that just never run out of money. Like, that's crazy. That should infuriate you as an American. It's like, those are your tax dollars on those EBDT and those cash cards that we're giving those migrants. They said, these aren't even migrants. These are asylum seekers. So, you know, if every single Haitian immigrant has that in that community, what about all these other people? I mean, I don't know what's going on, but it's not good for the country. It's not good for our economy. I mean, again, this is what happens when people think money just grows on trees. Technically, the paper money does grow on trees, but we're talking about the value. Like, the value of the dollar keeps going down because we just keep printing more. It's like, well, money can just be printed. No. Like, we determine the value of something. We determine the value of something. Like, the market determines the value of something.
Yep.
And it doesn't matter what it is. It's like, that's why young men are not valuable. Like, we have no use to society. We have no practical skills. But young women are super valuable because they're at the peak of their sexual marketplace value. That's why everybody likes 18-year-old girls.
Here's this next one here, and you sent me this one.
Yeah.
Libs of TikTok has posted this, or reposted it, I should say. Police chief outside of Springfield, Ohio, says his access to the police radio frequencies
have been denied.
Excuse me, was cut off. He has been warning about the rise in car accidents in his town from the Haitians.
So again, if you know anything about policing, which I know very little, I have several of my cousin's police officer. I have several police officer friends. If you're in the Army National Guard, basically half of the Army National Guard is police officers. But the frequency and that police officers have, like, they're able to listen to radio traffic from other nearby towns. Well, Springfield's like, nope, nobody else is going to be listening in on our conversations now because we want to make sure that there's no, you know, we don't want outsiders learning of what's going on in our town. Again, scary stuff.
I'll go ahead and play this video then.
Yeah, go for it.
You've got a city that's in absolute turmoil. Everybody's against everybody.
Chad Duncan is the police chief of Tremont City, Ohio, which is just outside of Springfield. He described the general atmosphere of lawlessness in Springfield, which he says is spreading to the surrounding area.
People that shouldn't be driving are out there and they're allowing them to drive.
Chief Duncan described one of his recent traffic stops involving a Haitian migrant.
He didn't even have a license, coming through town at 44 miles an hour in a 25 mile an hour zone. That's the second time in 2 weeks.
And you towed his car?
Oh yeah, towed it for the second time.
And Springfield wouldn't have?
No.
He suggested that one reason Springfield authorities might be going soft on reckless driving is to protect the Haitians' immigration status.
If you get two misdemeanors, you are subject to be deported.
Since Springfield became a media sensation.
In Springfield, they're eating the dogs, the people that came in, they're eating the cats.
Chief Duncan says his access to Springfield's police radio frequencies was cut off.
What exactly was going on with that?
Well, we were able to hear them on the radio. They have decided to go silent. We don't know what's going on in the city. That happened the day they brought the state troopers in to help them out.
Why would you think they would make things hard to communicate?
Nobody can hear what you say and they don't know what you're doing, so they'll have to answer to it. There was a threat at the school today. I couldn't hear it. I just caught wind of it from another chief that's
something
right next to the city.
Right.
If they would have taken the time, instead of worrying about the elites lining their pockets, and just took the time, this could have went so much smoother and been so much more beneficial to everybody involved. But instead,
good job, Chief.
And so because that didn't happen, how do you think this ends?
I really don't know what the end result will be, but right now it's not good.
Boom.
So that's my issue right there. It's like, this is the city officials and elites of that town covering their butts because they're getting some type of payback or cut or some type of, they're getting some type of government funding to bring in these migrants. I guarantee it.
Yeah.
And now the question is, are they using those funds to line their pockets or to help the city? And the way that they're acting like this, it's clearly to line some people in the city's pockets.
And again, this is what happens when you replace God with government and confuse government with charity. Like, look, whose job was it to be charitable? It was the church's job to be charitable. And the church got to counsel you. They got to be like, hey, your life's in shambles. You know, it's time for you to figure out what's wrong. You know, look up to the Lord and look within and solve your problems because we cannot permanently take care of you.
Mm-hmm.
But guess what? We've replaced God, the church with government, and now it's like we expect it's an expectation. The government's like, oh yeah, here's your EBT card, here's your cash card. We'll take care of you. Don't worry, husband. You don't need one of those. We'll take care of you. We're the government. We're your charity now. Again, we're creating a subservient slave class of. And it's a mindset, like, I mean, Kanye West said, it's a mindset. Like, if you are dependent on the government, you are a slave to that system. You want to be free of it. You want to be able to earn your own income. You want to be able to navigate life on your own and be able to take care of yourself. You don't want to have the government being like, oh, don't worry, we've got your back. It's like, no. You're confusing the purpose of government. The government's job is to enforce laws and to protect the people from outside threats. And it's the local town's job to protect themselves from the threats within the town. That's why you have a police force. You have And again, if you just lived in a perfectly Christian community and we all answer to a higher authority, there would be no need for a police force. It's like all the communists believe. It's like, there'll be no need to have, like, jobs and stuff. People will just do things because, you know, it's like, no, that's heaven. You know, in heaven, stuff it works like communism. You know, it's like that here on Earth, that don't work. Unless you have a community of people who have a similar belief and they believe in a higher authority and they feel like they'll be held accountable when the time comes, when they're called, yes, they will absolutely behave in a more moral way. But again, we're replacing God with government and government with charity.
Mm-hmm. Then here's this one, and this just goes to show you that it's spreading around. It's not just Springfield, Ohio anymore.
Oh, yeah.
So this is Fairhope, Alabama. This is a small town of 20,000 residents. 1,000 Haitians are possibly resettling there. A grieving mother spoke out today. Listen to her heartbreaking story. And this is hard to listen to. So, and this one's a little long, so get ready. Tighten your seatbelts.
Yeah.
My mother-in-law was recently killed in a tragic automobile accident in Grand Rapids, Michigan. This was in June 2022. She was not distracted. She was not on her phone. She was driving under the speed limit, seatbelt buckled, several car distances away, most likely with her hands at 10 and 2. She was as cautious and careful and law-abiding as they come. Born and raised in that area, she served at the local school for over 20 years, volunteered relentlessly at her church. She loved her community dearly and devoted her life to it in many ways. As she drove to pick up cabinet hardware to complete the dream kitchen she had worked on and waited 25 years for, her car rapidly approached a vehicle in front of her on US 131. She slowed and brought her vehicle to a complete stop as she realized that car in front of her was actually in reverse on the interstate. Though she saw him, though she controlled her own vehicle, another vehicle behind her didn't have the time or luxury of stopping. This woman was 37 years old in the car behind her. My mother-in-law was hit from the rear at full speed of 77 miles per hour by another innocent woman. Then her car imploded into the driver in front. They were both killed in the accident. Both Christians, both community servants, one a teacher, one a nurse, one single mother of two young children, now being raised without parents. The driver of the initial vehicle in reverse was a Haitian immigrant named Antoine Azard. He was the only driver that day to survive. He didn't speak English, so at the scene of the crime, there were dozens of police officers, state and local. He couldn't speak English to describe the account of the accident. It's taken 2.5 years for the trial.
Now we're paying for his medical expenses, too.
He was finally charged with 2 counts of reckless driving causing death. It's not fun to be here. It seems slightly terrifying to be here, to highlight our thoughts in a space of contentious debate and place ourselves on the chopping block of public conversation and strong opinion, especially in a small town like Fairhope. But as I grow older and my children grow older, I start to recognize the politics and policies around the world and how it affects everything around us. I feel it's more than wrong to sit back and complain rather than to rise up and speak out. I'm a mother, a Christian. I'm not racist or uncompassionate. I'm not a bigot.
Democrats say you are now.
I'm certainly not an pretentious entitled elite. I'm a wife, I'm a mom. I seek to be compassionate and caring and understanding. I seek to live a life that honors God and honors others, that loves others, that gives and cares too for others. I'm also a mom of 5 daughters. If my desire to help others endangered my own children by removing the locks on my doors and welcoming handfuls of young men, would that be the right thing to do in the name of compassion? Regardless of where they came from or how wonderful they were, my responsibility as a mother requires and demands my care and compassion first to protect my own. It would be neglectful and even abusive if I put the care of my own girls aside to accommodate the care of others. As tragic as my family's story is, I'm not here tonight to talk about Haitians or even immigration. I'm here to highlight what seems to be a growing concern for many of the citizens of this community and many across the country as a whole.
You.
The real issue I see brewing tonight isn't just about Fairhope or Baldwin County. It's about leadership across this country, mm-hmm. even in tiny communities like this one, seemingly usurping the will of the people, the very people in which they were appointed to represent. The issue at hand tonight has struck a chord, as you can see. Not because people are rude or selfish or self-serving or close-minded. It's not because they lean left or right, aren't loving, kind, or generous. A large portion is because somehow things like this seem to slip through, leaving the citizens concerned and confused as to how they weren't made aware. They weren't made a part of the discussion. That type of power and override is what this community, many who are here tonight and many who aren't, feeling like we are under the overarching rule of control rather than a community of information, understanding, and democracy. I'm not an expert on any of this. Just a concerned mom, concerned resident, grieving daughter-in-law, who sees the issues and inefficiencies around our area, ill-equipped for rapid growth and development, okay. The struggling who are already in front of us. I also see the beauty and blessings of this community.
So, again, if you want to know what a good society looks like, you'd be surprised. Like, traffic laws are a good indication of a society that functions in a healthy society. Like, seriously, I went to Mexico last year on a vacation. The way they drive there is astounding. I mean, it's similar, but, I mean...
Similar in the fact that you're driving a car.
Yeah, but, I mean, they do maneuvers on the road that I'm like, whoa, hey, what's going on here? Just get us to our destination alive. That's all I care about. Holy cow. But yeah, it's crazy. Like, and again, these Haitians don't speak English, so how are they don't understand the road signs? Like, I mean, hopefully road signs are somewhat universal, but again, who backs up on a highway that goes 77 miles an hour? Like, just, oh, I missed my get off. And then mom stops to try to avoid the wreck, and then the person behind him didn't realize that what's happening, boom. They're gone forever.
Yeah. Traffic laws, and what did we say the other one was? People returning grocery carts is a sign of a civilized society.
Yeah.
Because what's the joke? It's the Starship Troopers joke. Mm-hmm. It's a meme, but what's the difference between a civilian and a citizen? So the
citizen returns the shopping cart. Yeah.
The civilian does not.
The civilian does not. Gum. But yeah, no, And again, this is just one of many incidents. I mean, like that you had that one guy that his kid got run over by a Haitian immigrant, and he was like, I wish it was a white dude that did it, so we can stop talking, so racists won't stand up. It's like, has nothing to do with race. These people don't understand our traffic laws, and they don't care. Your son'd still be alive if these people understood our traffic laws and were required to take a better driving exam. In fact, I don't even think they just give them licenses when they're 18. Like, you don't even have to take the test. It's like, oh, you're 18. Yeah,
once
here's
you're
your
18,
license.
You get it. You don't have. I think there are some states that still require you to pass a driver's exam. But yeah, if you're 18 in most states, it's just here you go.
Nuts. But again, it's just it's the thing. And like I said, there and in Florida, we had that video of that horse that got eaten. You want to play that real quick before we? Yep.
Got it right here.
I mean, we had a whole bunch of videos today that we had just lined up one after the other. It's absolutely insane what's been going on here. So, whenever you're ready.
Yeah, let me just shift it over here.
Now, I said, there's no evidence that these horses were eaten by immigrants, but nothing like this has happened in this community. And again, we have the most large number of immigration. So the potential of it of being a hoax, I mean, it's possible. It's within the realm of possibility. But I mean, why would you actually fillet a horse? I mean, a horse is not considered a food animal like a cow. It's just considered a working animal.
And even if it's not an immigrant that did this, where are we at in a society where inflation and groceries are so high that people are literally resorting to butchering a horse?
What's the cause? Why on earth would people be at the point where it's like, well, I need to go out and fillet a horse to get meat? At what point are we in a society where it's like, hey, I mean, a steak costs like $5 at the store. It's like, well, I don't now. It costs like $50 per pack now. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. Go ahead and play the video. It's just it's enough to make you infuriated.
Found butchered about a mile away.
And tonight, their owners, as you can imagine, are looking for answers. The Tonight Team's Alex Browning has this exclusive.
For somebody to have the stomach to do something like this, this is heartless.
A heartless horse heist in Southwest Miami-Dade over the weekend.
This is the same thing as going into somebody's yard, taking their dog, and cooking it.
Turning deadly. Two horses swiped from Southwest Miami-Dade turned up dead. Their corpses found Sunday morning off Southwest 205th Avenue.
Notice that the fence was cut. And at that point, we realized that they were taken.
Owner David says it started sometime overnight Saturday. His two horses, Sammy and War, on the home front, stolen from their stalls off Southwest 207th Avenue.
There are children.
All cultures are equal,
and
folks.
They were abducted and killed for meat.
Their corpses later found a few blocks away.
Both horses were slaughtered sometime over the weekend. We need to come together, help out the detectives in this investigation. Let's give some closure to the family and, of course, put behind bars these individuals that would do such a heinous crime.
A mystery leaving a family heartbroken and now searching for answers.
You know, our children are heartbroken. My wife's heartbroken.
Two animals found.
Yeah, I mean, even this just goes to show you that it's spreading. That's Florida. So we've done Alabama, Florida.
Ohio.
I mean, and there's another one that I found that I have in here that's from Maine. I mean, I can pull that up. Yeah, you didn't know. It's the one of the migrant housing. They're canceling, and New York did the same thing. Like, they're slashing their homeless helping budget for migrants to build hotels and stuff. And that's one from Maine.
Or screw the people that already live here. Like, they had their chance at trying to be productive members of society. Let's help the newcomers.
Mm-hmm. Here it is, right here.
I just read an article that said they just built 60 new apartment complexes in Maine for migrants for free housing. Free housing, bro, for migrants in areas where there are already housing crises, where people cannot find housing, like apartments and affordable housing. So the people who already live here are already struggling to find apartments. And then they're like, let's build 60 new apartment complexes just for the migrants, and it'll be free. Please make it make sense. Why are
we make it make sense?
Doing
we're the
this
government.
Shit.
We do what we want.
Why are we not building this shit for the people that already live here?
Yep, that's what's happening. You wonder why prices of groceries is going up, why your taxes is going up, why your insurance with the car wrecks is going up,
why the price of housing market's going up. Well, there's a high demand for houses because there's a crap ton of immigrants here now, and they've got the magic money cards, and they're getting, California's giving them $50,000 grants to get homes. I mean, God willing, Oklahoma won't do anything like that, but holy Lord. We are living in the upside down world where it's like, hey, we give all the benefit. It is like modern business theory right now. You know what modern business theory is with cell phone companies, insurance, all this stuff? The long-term customers, or in the government's case, the citizens, be damned. We're going to give all the perks to the new customer, the person who just signs up. You're going to get Netflix for free. You're going to get, a discount on your phone. You're going to have we're going to get you a free phone if we replace this, and we're going to get you several months free, and you're going to love it, and you're going to get a really cheap plan. And then, like I said, after 2 years, that plan expires, and then it's like, it just goes straight up. Like I said, it's all for new, the government is doing the same thing businesses are doing. It's all about new customers and new business perks.
Yes.
Everything else is, you're just paying in. Like, We're the taxpayers. We're the pay pigs. We're the simps for the OnlyFans model, and the OnlyFans model is the government. Yeah. And we just pay them our tax dollars, and they give those tax dollars to the incoming immigrants and illegal immigrants and these child sex trafficking rings where they go, "Yeah, don't talk to this kid. I'm going to take this kid through the airport and take him. We're dropping these kids off at this abandoned house." And then the van comes and picks them up, and they follow the van around, and they try to lose the tail because we don't want to let you know where the kids are going.
And there's only one political party right now that is advocating for this stuff. Now, you can argue that the right is not doing a good job not, you know, trying to stop this stuff. But there is one party that is in just power solely all about mass immigration and covering up all these crimes. Like, it's not happening. Anyone that says this stuff is happening is a racist
You're
bigot.
A liar, a racist, a bigot, and a homophobe on top of that as well. No conversation can be had about this. Yeah,
but I know we're running short on time, so I guess we'll go ahead and finish it off with this one again. And this is one that you sent me, like that a guy. It's like that guy that we watched in London or whatever, asking people to take in migrants.
You house a migrant in your home? Oh, no. Well, I rent and I have a flat. I can't afford that.
Well, this dude right here has done it here in the United States, and it is perfect because he has a – I don't know if it's actually a migrant or if it's just his buddy.
He's both Mexican.
Yeah, they're just his buddy. And he's like, can you house this migrant? Yeah,
they're just Hispanic Americans, and they're just fucking – they're just trolling. Excuse me.
But it is glorious. We'll go ahead and play it. This is how we'll end the show today.
Is MAGA Republicans that are saying, you know, close the border.
No, I don't agree with the MAGA position on just about anything.
And it doesn't scare you if we open the border, maybe some illegal people could come in that maybe they're traffickers.
I don't buy that. Immigrants flowing into the United States is a net benefit for the economy.
All right, because we have Juan here who needs a home. Yeah. So all we're asking for, sir, is like if you could house him for a minimum of 3 months.
No, I'm not gonna house anybody.
Wait.
No, he's
a good guy and he's a hard worker. I swear.
Don't doubt it. I have a very small place. No, I live alone and I.
But sir, here's my question: if we're gonna open the border and you're not willing to provide, Yeah, he said yeah.
He said what?
No. It's opposite day, so it means yes.
Anyway, I'll say good evening.
Sir, can we at least agree that you don't actually believe in an open border?
Not in that sense.
Like, I mean,
so you do believe we should open the border?
Got him right there, man.
Got him.
Like, that's the truth, man. Come on. But yeah, I just want to end it on a more light note because today's subject is heavy, it's deep, and you know, we all want to do the thing that sounds nice, like, oh, just let everybody in, they just want to make a better life for themselves, but that might not be what this country needs, and it might not be what they need. They might need to be in their country, live in that hostile environment, and get to the point where they go, we have to actually make a positive change in our own government, in our own society, instead of escaping to a place that we don't share the same values of.
It's a problem that people don't talk about a lot. It's like the people who live there have to build their own society. It's a problem that they say that the England still talks about that they have with France right now, with the United States and Great Britain helping liberate France, is they don't truly feel like they liberated their own country.
Mm-hmm.
Or at least it wasn't them. And like, you know, it is up to you. Like, because somebody else comes to liberate you, you didn't do that. You know, you didn't free yourself. You didn't make your government, you know, because someone was helping you. I mean, and you can argue that's kind of the problems that we're having with the Middle East and other places like that right now, is like, here comes these places to help you out.
Well, America gave us freedom. How come they're not helping us maintain their freedom, freedom?
It's not our job to help you maintain your freedom.
Yeah. Again, a lot of change has to be done change has to come from within. It cannot be forced upon you. Which, you know, it's a lot of American foreign policy of late, but, you know, I mean, it's just the way it is. But that's about all I've got for you today. Sorry we just keep rambling, but like I said, today is a important subject, and it gets us hot. Us real hot and bothered under the collar. So
especially
when
there's a group of people just lying about it constantly.
Yeah. That's about all I've got for you today. This is the Twins with the Owasso Live. This was The Morning Loop. Be sure to like, share, and subscribe so you too can stay in the loop. We are signing off. God bless you.
See you later, everybody.